गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी. टुडे आई पल्लवी सिंह. आई एम हियर टू गिव अ सेशन ऑन फंक्टर्स एप्लीकेटिव्स एंड मोनाड्स. द ऑब्जेक्टिव फॉर टुडे सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी फंक्टर्स एप्लीकेटिव मोनाड्स फॉलोड बाय अ डेमो. लेट अस स्टार्ट बाय द प्रॉब्लम वी फेस, देन आई प्रोवाइड विद द सॉल्यूशंस. As such, if we talk about functors, applicatives and monads in context of Scala, there's no class, there's no trait like functors, monads or applicatives. It's actually a concept, but the implementation of that concept is already existing in Scala. So let's move to the first problem. We have a simple value and we apply a function to that value and we get a result. But now let's go a step further. What we now have, we have the value wrapped in some context, and the result of that value on application of a function will depend on that context. So how do we deal with this problem? The solution to this problem is functors. When a value is wrapped in a context, we cannot apply any normal function to that value. Because that value is inside, wrapped inside some container. You can call context as a container or some situation in which the value is wrapped. So one needs to take out that value and apply a function. So functors provides us a map. The map knows how to unwrap that value, apply the function, and then rewrap that value back into the context and give us back. If you talk in terms of definition, functor is a type class, and a functor is any data type that defines how map applies to it. Like I said, that there is no class, there is no trait, something called as functor in Scala. But still we have functors in Scala because we have lot of data types which provide us with the implementation of method map. Speaking informally, you can apply a function to a wrapped value using a map. The map knows how to apply that function and give you back the result. Suppose we have a constructor C and we have two types A and B, and we want to apply functions of the type defined. So we need to have some transformations. That is a transformation of function from this type to a function of that type. So we need to define a map which gives us this transformation. The examples of functors in Scala are options, streams, futures, lists, and so many. Let me show you by a demo. Here, I have defined a class functor which takes a value of type T. That can be anything. Then what I have defined is a map from which can have a value of type A and B. It takes in a function, a raw function, which is from of type A to B, and returns me a function which takes in a functor of type A and gives me a functor of type B. And I also provided the implementation that how it is going to return me a functor of type B. Let's have a concrete implementation of this. As I have already told you that we need transformation, and for the example I am working on, we'll need a transformation of functor of string to a functor of int. So what I have done is, first, the first function drawLength of string defines a transformation of string to int. The next, I have created a string container which is a functor of type string. You can see Nodler Software LLP. Now what I have done is, to this string container which is of type functor, I have applied a map and provided this map with a function of type which is string to int. You can see from the definition, right? I provided this function. What I get as a result is a functor of int from a functor of string. So, I define a function from string to int, then I define a functor of string, then I define a function which gives me from a functor of string to a functor of int, and here's the value.
This is basically functor is to just explain how our internal functor, we by default functor like option function, how they work.
It's simply that we have a context and we have a value in that context, and it is not necessary for us to take out that value from the context. We can transform that value inside that context itself. Another example, the first one was of conversion from string to int. The next one is conversion of int to string. That's quite similar. The interesting part is that it is applicable for even user-defined data types. In the application 3, what I've done is I've defined a class book. It has three parameters. Then I've defined another class, a library book, which has an additional parameter and a method which adds an ISBN number to it. You can consider it some reference number or something like that. So what the aim, my aim is going to be, now I'm going to use this functor. Suppose I have this book class wrapped in some context. So what my aim is going to, I have to change this to a library book. So simply what I have done is, I have defined a conversion from book to library book, and I have provided that conversion to my functor. So I am able to convert the value of book to a library book being inside the context, that is being inside my functor. Now let's address a similar problem. What if we have a function which is applied to another function? So we have we get another function. So the crux of the problem is you must have used multiple functions stacked together in Scala. So it is like functions are also functors. What happens is the map method for two functions for the conversion to happen is like function composition. Now let's move to the second problem.
Before that, let me show you a scenario of how I have got the second problem.
See, in this example, what we have done is we have defined a function x. It takes two parameters of type x and y. And what I do is, I've defined a future of 42 and I've tried to map it with this function. So what's the problem here? The problem here is, to a map, I can only provide a function which takes in a single parameter. But we all know we can use current functions to provide, to make functions. Like if we have functions of n parameters, I can curry them to have a function which takes single parameter and gives me back a function of n minus 1 parameters. But the problem arises in case of option, futures and all these things, that the map doesn't know how to work with the futures. It doesn't know how it will apply and everything will be done. So the solution for this comes from applicative functors. I'll come back to this problem again.
What's the shortcut to come to
Shift F5.
So, in the present scenario, what we have a value wrapped in a context and a function wrapped in context too. Again, the same thing happens, that the function doesn't know how do we apply the function if the function itself is wrapped in a value. So we need to define some transformation, and that transformation happens to be some method called as apply. So that apply method knows how to perform that transformation. Actually, what is happening at the back end is we have a function wrapped in a context and we have a value wrapped in a context. The apply method knows how to pull out the value from the context, pull out the function from the context, apply the function on the value and give us back the result, that too wrapped in a context. If you go by the definition, applicative is a type class, and applicative is any data type that defines how applies to it. That is, apply is the name of the method. So apply takes a functor that has a function in it and another functor that extracts the function from the first functor and then applies, like that it knows how to apply it or put a map over it. Speaking informally, we can say a function wrapped in a context to a function wrapped in a context, right? So we have a constructor C and again two types A and B, and we want to apply these transformation. But now what we have is a function where A goes to B is defined in terms if is inside a context. So we need to have a implementation for the apply method. Let's see with a demo. In this, I have defined a class applicative which takes a type T, and I have defined a method apply and its implementation. Here you can see the parameter with a small b is of type applicative. That is, inside a context we have a transformation from A to B, and what I get in the result is a transformation of applicative A to applicative B. So what we have done is we have defined a container, a applicative of type string. I again define a transformation from string to int. Then what we have done is we have directly defined a new applicative which is of type, which takes a function of type transformation string to int. I get a function transformed length to which I apply this, to which I use the apply method and provide this raw function, this function applicative, right? And I get a result which is an applicative of int. Just have a look at string to int, then from applicative which is of for transformation from string to int, and then we get a transformed length, and finally we get an applicative of int. Coming back to the scenario which I started with, what happens is that the map did not know how to work with functions wrapped inside future. So the solution was applicative functors. Here I have just used a function called zip. What zip does is it has an apply method implemented which knows how to pull out values from two or more futures, and then it performs the functionality on those values and returns us a value wrapped back in a future. So this is what is happening here. Previously we were unable to use this kind of things. If the applicative or the apply method wasn't defined.
The zip is an inbuilt function.
Zip is an inbuilt function.
It's future inbuilt.
Yeah, not a future inbuilt function. It's a function which is inbuilt, but and it has a functionality that it can wrap two or more futures. Right? If you have two or more futures, then and a function defined like calculate I've defined here. So what I do is I provide that calculate function. And whatever two or more futures I have, it pulls out the value, applies the function, and gives me back the value result in a future. Now let's go to the last final problem. That is, what if we have, if we are given a function which takes a value and returns us a wrapped value? That is not a problem, we have already discussed that. But what happens if we feed the function with a wrapped value? the solution is given by monads. Monads apply a function that returns a wrapped value for a wrapped value. And the function is given a wrapped value and it returns me back a wrapped value. How it does that is simply it takes out the value from the context, gives it to the function evaluates the value and it returns me the result. Like here in the example you can see the function, as you can see it is just a function which determines whether a number is even or odd. So what it does for me is it takes out the value 3 from the context, gives it to my function and it evaluates it there and it realizes that it's not an even number, so I have nothing to return. So it returns me nothing. Nothing means like if we can compare sum and none. So it is kind of returning me a none which is wrapped in a context. Example of this kind is like supposedly I have got a file name wrapped in a context and I have a function which can take a file name. But what a monad is going to do for me, it is going to pull out that file name. I'll put that into the function which function will return me the file, but it will be wrapped in a context too. Then again I'll be needing a monad. The monad is going to fetch that file out from the context for me and I'm going to give it to another function and which is going to print that file. So as per the definition, monad is a type class. A monad is a data type that implements the flat. Speaking informally, you apply a function that returns a wrapped value to a wrapped value. We have a constructor type of type C and two types A and B, and we want to apply the transformation of from A to a transformation of type from A to a context type B, and in turn I get a result in form of a context of A transformed into context of B. So I need to define a method called flatmap. Defining flatmap is not the only method I need to define to make monads. There's another method that is called as a unit method. Actually monads need to follow two rules. That is the rule of neutral element and the rule of associativity. Neutral element is like identity. What it does for me is it converts a value of type into a monad of that type. The example of monads are list, set, options and future. All are monads. So kind of like everything you feel is too complex but you deal with it so easily. So you can say it's a monad. A bit of elaboration of futures, like if you want to see, if I say a future is a monad, why do I say so? Is like I have a future and I have got some value in the future. What I do is I have two options. First of all, either I apply a method called onComplete, onSuccess, onFailure, which is a kind of a blocking function because it waits for the application of function till the value arrives. The other way is I apply a flat map on that. And what I do, in the flat map, I just need to specify what functionality I want to do once the value arrives. So that's kind of how monads help us.
For each is also part of monad. For each.
I'm not sure.
Because functors like convert one type of value into other.
You can for each a simple high order function. You can define anywhere. Even that is not a monad.
But
our maps, I mean, this is not
also a high order function. I think the monad or functor are categorized their types. Monad or functor.
I am simply saying. For each is not a property of monad.
Yes. So, like for a monad to be a monad, it needs to have a flat map and unit.
These two methods need. What actually happens is we do not have actual implementation of monad in our general Scala. So but actually monads exist in Scala because what happens is there are so many data types which have their this list method. When we say list, into bracket some value, what happens is list dot apply and that value that apply there is the unit method. So we have that unit method for list and we have a flat map for a list, right? So when we have a unit method and when we have a flat map for that value, then we can say it's a monad.
For each is also unit method.
Sorry?
For each is also unit method.
But
that unit.
Unit is just a way of like saying that you are wrapping something in a monad.
Or second way you can say identity function. If I say for multiplication, the identity is one, right? Yes, a value something, I am multiplying a value, that resulting a same value.
Same value, right.
For my addition, it is zero, right? That is unit.
So this identity or unit function should return the same type for what we are providing to it.
Yes, sir.
But okay, if I have a scenario where we are trying to find out the length of a string,
right?
But that identity function, identity means it will provide me the same result.
It will provide me a same result when we say it in terms of a, like, so there are two things. There's a mathematical definition for a thing and we have a programming language definition for that. What sir and we all were talking about was a mathematical definition of a thing. But when I say a programmatic definition of it, the programmatic definition is that I have a type T that is not defined. So the conversion from type T to context of type T, that is going to be the identity for me.
Exactly. So what I am trying to say is that my type T is string.
Right.
But I want to learn the length of it.
Right, sir.
So in the context, I will be having integer.
Right, sir.
So will it be identified, yes, as an identity function? No.
No, sir. That won't be an identity function. The conversion from int to string. You have a string. From string to context of string. That is going to be my identity function. What my flat map method is going to do, it is going to provide that conversion from context of string to context of int.
But it doesn't matter, it's returning the same result every time.
But that identity method is just there because we have, like, when we are implementing things. So that is based on that mathematical concept. So it has to follow those kind of rules. That is why it exists there. Maybe I'm not able to explain in that way. I can get back to you on that. So here what I've done is I've defined a monad of type T and I've defined the flat map implementation for that. So what happens is it takes a function which is a transformation from A to monad of type B and returns me a function which is a transformation of monad A to monad B. So what I've done is I've defined a monad of type string. Then I've defined a function which converts a string to int and I pass that method to flat map. And hence I obtain a monad of type int. Conversion from string to int, then from monad of string to monad of int, and finally a monad of int. Now the obvious question which comes is, like, what is the difference between monad and monoids? Before I give the difference, let's talk what is a monoid. So given a type T and a binary operation which results in T, when I talk of T is a set, it returns a value in the set itself and an instance 0, then the triplet of T operation in 0 is called a monoid. And it follows two properties, that is a neutral element and associativity. Having said that, the difference between monad and monoid is that monad just knows how to pull out a value from a context and apply a function on that value. But monoid, it knows how to combine two or more values of the same type in a given context. Another question which can arise is like, we have been discussing applicatives, functors and everything. So monads are powerful than applicatives. Yes, it is true that monads are powerful than applicatives. The reason for monads being powerful than applicatives is that when we define a monad, so what happens is what we do, use monad for sequence of computations. So monad provides us an additional functionality that the computations, if they are happening in a sequence, the value of the subsequent computation can depend on the value of the previous computation. So it allows us dependencies. Any questions?
What is the use cases of applicative?
Sir, applicative use cases are like, often we have values wrapped in futures and options. So when we have like multiple values, like supposedly, if I can take an example, if I got the vertices of a triangle, and I want to calculate the value, what happens is, sir, I cannot apply a map there because I'll have the value in three futures, right? In that case, the map doesn't know how to work. There, my applicative is going to work. I can sequence the computations. These are my references. The first one is a really nice reference. You can all go through that. Thank you.